this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and I will be glad in it. Man, listen, it's been 6 long weeks.
Wasn't that bad?
No, it was bad. It was bad. It's been pre-recorded services every Sunday, as you know. But this is our first back live since August.
Except for senior.
Senior
preached us into a fit for Sunday.
Into a coma. So as you can see, I'm still limping a little bit, but I've got my cane with me, but I'm not walking on my cane. God is still a healer.
When I tell you he is a healer, how many of you all can testify to that? He has healed our bishop. He is still healing our bishop, yeah, if he would be obedient and sit down. But anyway.
So, you know, they were a little leery about my timetable to come back. But I'm preaching next Sunday. I'm going to preach next Sunday no matter what. But it's so good to be. This has been an exciting morning. And a little later in the service, we're going to show you some video. But camera, if I can get, I don't know if it's the crane to pan the audience. We've got some of our students and parents who are here this morning. We gave away, we had 85 scholarships to give away.
85.
And all but 14 were picked up this morning and some stayed for worship. So if we could get y'all to just kind of pan the audience for me. We now you see where there are blank spaces, but they're white name tags. Every name tag represents someone who got a scholarship. I'm going to talk about it a little later. We're going to show you video. But man, everybody in your house, wherever you are, ought to be shouting because your giving made possible. Listen, in a pandemic,
you gave so that we could give out 85, not one, not 10, 85, you guys. So I hope y'all are praising in your house. I hope you're shouting in your house. Thank God for this ministry and thank God for you. And that's why we always encourage you to give so we can continue to do things like this.
Now, there were some students who are already gone. So we've got a few parents who are in the house this morning. And I'm going to talk about that a little later as well. It's just good, Bethel, to be back in the house. Hey, y'all keep playing that. Quinn messed me up. This is my first Sunday back. Quinn knows that's my favorite song in the world. Why they would start playing that on me today is a mess. But and so the Lord blessed me Thursday. I turned 55.
Come on, give it up. Bishop had a birthday.
Yeah.
Thursday.
55.
55.
And man,
double grace.
So many members sowed into my life. And I want to thank you, Pastor, and the staff. They put my Cash App up on social media. And and if you missed it, it's RUMCKJR. That's the Cash App.
RUMCKJR.
Yeah.
Well, we had to do it like we would do it if we were in worship. And if we were open and in worship, we would have celebrated our bishop. Amen. So we wanted to make sure you felt the love.
I did.
All the way at the house.
I did.
Although we could not be here to celebrate corporately.
I did. It was amazing. Our daughters came home. Janae is in grad school, so she came home but had to get back. Y'all, she's in grad school. But my oldest, my baby, my ace, Jocelyn came home and she's still home. And Joshua, they're both here today because their mama is going to preach today. Pastor is going to preach the gospel today. And so I'm going to take over all her duties because I want her to go sit down. You're preaching the gospel.
Well, my God.
So listen, wherever you are in your house, I need you to take an ussy or a selfie. And make sure, and definitely in the sanctuary, I need y'all taking a selfie. But wherever you are watching right now, even if you're watching at home, take a selfie. Grab some of your co-workers if you're at work. Put your mask on. I don't care what the governor said. I do not care. We are not in phase 3 in Bethel. We're in phase God. And God said, don't you open that place back up yet. So don't, and especially as African Americans, y'all got to remember every law and rule they make never has us in mind. which is why I got my shirt on. Y'all see my shirt today? I know it's already being controversial, and I know somebody's looking at it saying, Lord, he come back wearing controversy. Yeah, I got the shirt on. Arrest the cops who killed Breonna Taylor.
Yes,
period.
Period.
Period. But take a ussie, take a selfie this morning. If you're watching on Facebook, hit the share button so that all of your Facebook friends can share. If you're watching on YouTube, if you're watching on the website, I should have had the kids come join me instead of you. But I won't do that to them because I see the looks on their faces. If you're watching on YouTube, if you're watching on the website, call somebody, text somebody, tell them that the Bethel Experience is on. Even you take an ussie or a selfie if you're watching over there. And if you have a social media platform, you post your picture there, but especially on the Facebook page of the Bethel Church so that we can know you're listening. So now, because they started playing my song, I done switched everything up already, Meacham. So y'all already know. You already know what we're going to do. We're going to do the video before the sermon. So here's what I want you to do. Wherever you are in your house, see, this is the danger of a musical pastor. Wherever you are in your house, I want you to get up, put your coffee down, put your toast down, put your book down, and I want you to stand up all in your home. I want you to stand up in the sanctuary if you're in here, and we're just going to enter a little worship, y'all. I just feel like entering into a little worship. I want you to sing this in your home or in your car, wherever you are. Can you sing it with us? Hallelujah, you have won the victory. Sing it loud enough in your house for me to hear it. Hallelujah, you've won it all. I hear you in the sanctuary. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen. You are the risen King, seated in majesty, seated in majesty. You are the risen, you are the risen King. Come on, everybody, all over the house in sanctuary. Hallelujah. I hear you. You have won. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You have won it all for me. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King. Come on, seated. Everybody lift your hands and say it together. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, Zion.
You have won the victory.
I hear you, Zion. Yes.
Hallelujah. Yeah. You have won. Death could not hold. You are the rich. Seated in majesty.
Can you say that one last time? Come on.
Death could not hold. You are the ring.
Come on, one more time.
Death could not hold. You are the ring. Seated in majesty. Woo! You are the risen king.
Come on, all over your house.
Death could not hold. You are the risen King.
Come on, somebody, give God a good praise, not only in the sanctuary, but even in your home. Give God a good praise. Come on, praise Him like you know He is the risen. Hallelujah. Boy, it's so good to be back in this house. Come on, y'all can sit down in the sanctuary. Yeah, I'm smarter than I used to be. I ain't trying to prove nothing, so I better sit down so I don't stand up this whole, and I'm practicing for next Sunday. Next Sunday, I'll be back. We'll be back live. I'm starting a series next Sunday entitled Help Yourself to a Miracle. I'm a firm believer that God still does miracles, y'all. And so next Sunday, we're going to start an amazing series, and I'm so excited. Man, I am just so excited about your stewardship commitment. Your commitment to stewardship is just and has been so amazing during this pandemic. We have not gone without. We've been able to do fresh and consistent and creative ministry. One of those is something I mentioned this earlier this morning at the beginning of the service, and you saw the camera panning of the sanctuary, but we've got some video. If they could throw that up now. Y'all got a camera? I mean, a TV where I can see? I can't see. Oh, it's not working right now. Okay. Oh, I can see it up here, though. If we can throw. Yeah, these are students, and I want to give a shout out to our scholarship committee. 85 students picking up their scholarships. Y'all didn't hear what I said. 85 students picking up scholarships, none less than $1,000. Y'all didn't hear what I just said. Bethel is the baddest church on the planet. I don't care what anybody says. Who gives out 86 scholarships in normal times, much less in a pandemic? You gave this. Here's what's crazy. You all gave this on a six-hour telethon in the middle of the pandemic. This was not stretched over 4 to 5 week time. This was not in partnership with corporate sponsors who gave us matching funds. Every dime that we are able to give these students is because of your faithful stewardship. That is absolutely amazing, y'all. 86 students have, one of the parents brought a picture of her daughter. Where is that? There it is. I don't know if we can get a camera way over there, but she brought a picture of her baby. She came to pick it up today. And how many other parents we got in the house? Yeah, we got a few parents in the house today. And I'm just so excited about what the Lord has allowed us to do. And Bethel, it is because of your faithful giving. That's why your giving is so important, because it allows us during this season to not simply be a church that has virtual worship on Sunday. No, it is your giving that allows that. Very soon, you're going to hear me probably next Sunday begin to talk about our next endeavor, and that is we are coming up with a creative way to bless 1,000 families during Thanksgiving. 1,000 families during Thanksgiving. So many families have been impacted by this pandemic and the coronavirus, with layoffs and sicknesses and the like. And once again, because you've been faithful in your giving, you've been consistent in your stewardship, it has allowed your leaders to continue to be creative during this season. Hey, real quick, y'all shout out the father and mother of the house, Bishop Senior and Lady Estelle. Put it in the chat on Facebook how much you love them and thank God for them as well. And so this morning, I need you to continue in the faithful stewardship. Cash App, you know our Cash App. I'm sure the giving platforms will be up on the screen. Yeah, there we go. Cash App is the Bethel Experience. Givelify is Bethel Baptist Jacksonville. You can also, as you see, text to give. You can text to give, and you text. Now that's wrong. We don't text push pay. What do we text? Yeah, Bethel Jacks. So Jerome, we got to change that. I never paid attention to that. Text Bethel Jacks to 77977. So don't pay attention. I hope nobody's been trying to give that way and has went the wrong way. We text 77977, but text the word Bethel Jacks. We'll have that fixed before next Sunday, because text to give is an easy way to give. You text to give, it'll send you a link, and you give that way. So once again, so everybody hears me, Bethel Jacks, you text that one word, type it as one word, Bethel Jacks, J-A-X, and you text it to 77977. So once again, Cash App is the Bethel Experience. Givelify is Bethel Baptist Church, Jacksonville. Text to give is Bethel Jacks to 77977. If you're on the website or if you're on YouTube, you can go over to the website and you can go to the giving tab and give through the website, or you can go and use any of the other giving platforms I have mentioned. Of course, our trustees, as they have been even for these 6 weeks when we were doing pre-recorded, they are here, they are out front. And if you want to bring your tithe down to the church, I just noticed y'all got purple and gold balloons in the back. Is that for me? That's for me. I don't know how I missed that. I just noticed y'all aren't here, I'm sorry, but they got purple and gold balloons in the back. I guess that's for my birthday. You know, somebody used to say it like that. They said birthday. Yeah. Wow. Thank y'all. Y'all gonna mess me up and make me cry. I've gotten sentimental as I get older. But so your giving is so, so important. Listen, a couple of other reminders. Digital discipleship is getting ready to start, and I am so excited about these small group opportunities for us to grow together. We're going to be studying, everybody's going to be studying the same book. The book is entitled 10 Dumb Things Smart Christians Believe. 10 Dumb Things That Smart Christians. Do we have the flyer? If we could put the flyer up for me, please. Thank you so much. There we go. That's the women. No, I want the original flyer. Dungeon, put the original flyer up for me. It's beginning. It's getting ready to start. And I'm so excited. We've got several groups now. Let me say this. Women, your group, as a matter of fact, we've had to create three groups because we had so many women that registered. But if you are one of our queens and you have not registered yet, that does not mean you cannot register. If you are a wife, I want to encourage you to register for the Covenant Keepers, or you can register for Bondage Breakers or Living Witness. Or if you are single, no, singles is closed too, but if you are a young adult, you can still register. Now, the men and young adults are very close to our capacity. And so I'm encouraging everybody today, men, young adults, singles. Are they just putting each one up? Is that what they're going to do? All right, cool in the game. So men, so as they're putting each flyer up, if you see yours, you'll know what to do. So once again, men, young adults. Next, I want to talk to everybody 18 to 23. That's what next gen means. We've got a lot of you in the church. And I want to encourage you, even if you're watching me virtually from somewhere else, we have a next gen group that's going to be absolutely powerful, absolutely powerful. And so I want to encourage all of you ages 18 to 23 to register for the next gen class. Covenant Keepers, that's for married couples. Married couples, I want to encourage you to join our small groups, our communities, if you will. And Living Witness and Bondage Breakers are actually two of our Sunday school classes, but we're opening it up to everyone during this small group season. These are not small groups, y'all, that will just be during pandemic. These will be ongoing, and they will have a cyclical look to them. We will cycle through different books. Some seasons, lessons will be on my sermons. And I'm really excited about the opportunity for us to grow together in grace, for us to stretch our faith and mature our discipleship. And so once again, they were flashing them on the screen. And I'm encouraging every man, every woman, every young adult, every single, every married couple to register now. Don't wait till service is over because you'll forget because you got your collard greens on the stove. Go do it now, just like you're going to give now. We've got some phenomenal teachers, some new people that will be teaching that you have not necessarily seen in a teaching capacity. And I want you to be prepared and excited for what's going to be a great time. As soon as you register, you will get the date and time digitally at your phone or on your iPad or on your desktop or laptop, the time and date for your particular class. This coming Saturday, and I thank God for Executive Pastor Caldwell and for our Healthy Bethel ministry and for our grief ministry. This coming Saturday at 9 a.m., there will be a free virtual caregivers symposium. It's going to be on Zoom. Real strategies for practical family issues. There will be resources provided for those who are dealing with grief. You see the flyer, hopefully right now on your screen. It's up. It's going to be a phenomenal. So many people have experienced loss in this season, and there are many people who experienced loss before this season but have not brought closure to their grief. And I want to encourage you this Saturday at 9 a.m. to be a part of that Zoom. Now, you can register. I'm going to read this off to you, and it's case sensitive. It's on the flyer as well. But register lowercase bit.ly / capital CGB lowercase ETHEL. We're going to have the flyer up all week. Don't worry about it. It will be on all of our social media platforms for you to register all this week. Next Sunday is the first Sunday of October. That is crazy. The first Sunday in October, we will celebrate the Lord's Supper. And so this coming week, on Wednesday and Thursday, from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m., do I have that right? 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. on Wednesday and Thursday. Our deacons will be here for you to come through, drive up, pull up, and pick up your communion sacraments. And so this coming Wednesday and Thursday, I urge everybody to pick them up. That doesn't mean if you don't pick it up that you cannot participate. Grab you some saltines, some crackers, some juice, some wine, whatever you're going to grab, and celebrate the Lord's Supper with us on next Sunday. I'm so excited about being back in the pulpit next Sunday. It's going to be an absolute powerful day. Don't forget the again seed. As Pastor is preaching this morning, if you've already given your tithe and your offering, the again seed is when the Holy Spirit checks you, challenges you, or stretches you through something said during the preaching of the word. And you go back to the Cash App, to the Givelify, to Text to Give, and you give an again seed to say, God, thank you for what was just spoken. Y'all, I'm so excited. It's preaching time. I'm so excited, so excited, so excited, so excited. This woman of God, she's my wife, she's my love, she's my friend, she's my intercessor, she's my baby's mama, all three of them, and just an amazing woman of God. She just graduated this year, y'all, with her MDiv. She starts in the fall on her PhD. I'm just playing. But she has got an anointing on her life unlike anything you've ever imagined. She is our wonderful executive pastor. She's the leading lady of the Bethel Church. And she is preaching today. Over the last 5 years, we've always had a guest preacher on the weekend of my birthday. And the Lord said to me, you ain't got to ask nobody to send you a sermon. Put your wife up. You know she's anointed. You know, God, that I have gifted her, I heard the Lord say. And she's going to preach this morning, y'all. I got a feeling glory is going to fall in this place. So I need you to get ready. Hey, before that, our choir has put together another thing. I just want to shout out Brother Meacham and our band and our worship and arts ministry. They have been so creative over the last weeks. And they've put together another amazingly creative video. Don't just sit there and watch and listen. Let it usher you into worship. And as soon as they are done, Pastor Kim is going to come and she is going to preach the gospel unto us. Dungeon, take it away.
Moses asked of the Lord, who should I say sent me? And the Lord responded, I am that I am. That's who God is. Before I talk about who God is, I might as well tell you who God is not. God is not someone who should lie. God is not able to not deliver what he said he was going to be able to do. God is not going to fall short of his word. God is not in a respecter of person. Promotion may come from the east and it ain't going to come from the west. It is going to come from the Lord. God is. He is a waymaker. He's a miracle worker. God is the joy and the strength of my life. God is, in the words of my grandmother, a wheel in the middle of a wheel. He is a friend that sticks closer than any brother. He's food when you're hungry. He's water when you're thirsty. He's a friend when you feel like you're in it all by yourself. God is the one who can talk you on the ledge, then become the parachute if you jump off the cliff. God is your therapist to keep your mind together. God is the banker that gives you a loan even when you know you ain't gonna pay it back. God is the comforter when you find yourself blowing balloons for your own pity party and packing luggage for a guilt trip. God is a bridge over troubled waters. God is the great I am. And on this day, I am pleased to report, according to the elders in heaven, those who are the scribes in the earth, and those who are on angelic assignment, God is the God of Bishop Rudolph Waldo McKissick Jr. Because of what I've seen God is to him, I know what he can be for me. I have assurance that he's God big enough to be God. Whatever you're going through, remember, God is, and God is greater than everything that was, everything that is, and everything that is to come.
Brother, I wish I could sing it how I really felt it. I wish I had the voice. But if there's anybody that can testify to the strength of God, it's you. We've seen you walk in it, rely on it, and bounce back because of it. You have lived the scripture that his strength is made perfect in weakness. You are living proof that strength is not synonymous to stature, though, because you're the shortest out of us all, but indeed the strongest. Back surgery, prostate cancer, vocal cord collapsing, and now full knee replacement. It's been a joy to see you thrive because of his strength. Happy birthday, man. You deserve a break today because you survived the breaks of yesterday. Live in this strength. Lift your hands, McKissick. Enjoy this time. You are here because of his strength. I praise your name. I can't sing it. I wish I could. Happy birthday.
Church, come on, y'all. You are. place to pause and just begin to magnify the God of your salvation. He's a worthy God, fam. Yes, he is. Totally and completely. Just think about his goodness. Think about his kindness. Think about the tender mercy that he's shown towards you in this season. Don't you sit there. Don't you act like he ain't did nothing for you. Open up your minds and just give him an unrestricted praise.
To me, a disciple of Christ, it is our duty to rejoice. Come on and put those blessed hands together in the sanctuary and in your house, in your worship space. Our God is worthy to be praised. I'm not telling you what I heard. I'm telling you what I know. Our God is worthy to be praised. If you know it for yourself, say it. My God is worthy to be praised. Come on and give him a shout of hallelujah. He brought you to this place on today for such a time as this. You ought to give him some praise. Somebody didn't get up this morning, so you ought to give him some praise. He brought you here to this house. He put church going on your mind. He put breath in your body. And somebody ought to give my God some praise. Hallelujah. He's worthy from the mountaintop. He's worthy even in the valley low. He's worthy. My God is an awesome God. Come on and praise him on today. He's so worthy. Even in this pandemic, my God is still moving. Even in this quarantine, my God is big. Even in what you're going through, my God still reigns. Hallelujah, hallelujah, and amen. Woo, I've been holding that and holding it, but my God is awesome. My God is amazing, and I want you all to praise with me. He can do anything, and he's kept us. In this pandemic, he kept you to bring you here today. So you ought to leap for joy. You ought to shout hallelujah. You ought to clap your hands and say amen. Know about you, but if you don't give God praise whenever he gives you the chance, I don't want any rocks to cry out for me. I know how to praise him for myself. And so we here on the day, September 27th, and say, God, we love you, we thank you, and you are worthy to be praised. You're so worthy. There is only one name by where men shall be saved. His name is Jesus. Glory to God, glory to God. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Stop that, Quinn. Well, while we're here, while we're at it, you know how they say, well, while we're here, we might as well. And since you're in the sanctuary today, you all are the remnant who can give God a praise for those who are not here. So you might as well do it right now. You are the remnant who's giving praise for all. Lord, get your shout over there, mother. Us shout like that. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We want to give all praise and glory and honor to the one who sits on high. Amen. To the, our creator, our sustainer. Amen. Our redeemer, our shelter, our refuge, our hope. His name is Jesus. If you don't know him, I convict you today to get to know him. Hallelujah. In the pardon of your sins. We are so delighted to be here. As they say in the church, we're so delighted to be here. Thank you all for being here today. Bishop, it's your birthday weekend. Happy birthday, Bishop. Y'all say happy birthday, Bishop. It's been an amazing weekend, and we surprised him today with that medley today. I want to thank the Covenant Brothers. Y'all don't know what it took to get that in. Jesus, Apostle, LaQuinn, and Bishop, that was the brainchild of your music ministry. LaQuinn reached out to me to get the Covenant Brothers together, so I want to thank you. LaQuinn, you all did y'all's job because he sat here and cried like a baby. You all couldn't see on the screen, so I got to tell you what's happening on the scene. He cried like a baby. And so we want to shout out to our music ministry who have just been so faithful. You all give them a shout of praise right now. They've been so faithful, and y'all can do better than that. They've been here laboring with the bishop and then even still with the recorders, and so we're so thankful to Apostle Clark for his leadership in that ministry of the worship and finance. You all didn't, yes, Apostle Clark is the leader of the worship and finance ministry, to Jerome Davis and his team, and then to our bishop, our visionary, our pastor, our under shepherd. Amen. We're so thankful. Can y'all give God some praise? Help me praise him for our pastor today, who has not wavered in his obedience and his commitment to the cause of Christ. And so he's been standing in season and out of season, as they say. He's been standing no matter what. And so we're so thankful for his commitment and dedication to the kingdom and to his calling. I love you, babe. Thank you so much for this opportunity. I will not be before you long, as they say. It won't be long, but it'll be strong. And so we're so grateful for this opportunity. To all of you all are out there, Bishop Senior and Lady Estelle, come on, you all give God praise for them. To my mom, I think my bishop told me she was watching, so if she is, to my mom, I love you. But I'm so grateful for this opportunity, and I want you all, did I forget anything, babe? You know how this goes when you're up here, you get stuff. I want you all to turn to Judges chapter 7. To my children who are here, like he said, Janae was here, but she had to go back. Y'all, she's in grad school, praise the Lord. And so she needed to go back, and she had some other things going on that were time sensitive, so she had to leave to go back. And so I said, listen, we need you to do what you have to do. But if she's watching, and I love you, baby, and I feel your spirit here. But to Jocelyn, who's home from the ATL, and Joshua, who is here with us, I salute them also. They are my three joys, y'all. I will cut you to the white meat over them. And so I'm so grateful that they are that they are here with me today. Judges chapter 7, and we're going to start at verse 1. Early in the morning, Jerubbaal, that is Gideon, and all his men camped at the spring of Herod. The camp of Midian was north of them in the valley near the hill of Moreh. The Lord said to Gideon, "You have too many men. I cannot deliver Midian into their hands, or Israel would boast against me. My own strength has saved me. Now announce to the army, anyone who trembles with fear may turn back and leave Mount Gilead." So 22,000 men left, while 10,000 remained. But the Lord said to Gideon, there are still too many men. Take them down to the water, and I will thin them out for you there. If I say this one shall go with you, he shall go. But if I say this one shall not go with you, he shall not go. So Gideon took the men down to the water. There the Lord told him, separate those who lap the water with their tongues as a dog laps from those who kneel down to drink. 300 of them drank from cupped hands, lapping like dogs. All the rest got down on their knees to drink. The Lord said to Gideon, with the 300 men that lapped, I will save you and give you the Midianites into your hands. Let all the others go home. The word of God for the people of God. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Father God, we thank you, O Lord, for this time. We thank you, O Lord, for this day. We're just so grateful for all that you are to us, Lord God. We don't want to thank you for anything, but thank you for what you've done for us, O God, who you've been to us, O God. We're just so grateful to you, O Lord, for this time of sharing, Lord God. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. While growing up, I would often hear my grandparents say, and actually for my parents for that matter, they would always say, we did more with less. Because I'm preaching from less is best. Less is best. Of course, after they said that, there was a conversation they followed about how they had less than we have available now to us, but was able to satisfy the need and get things done. They didn't have the advancements of technology and the fast-paced comforts like we have now that we've grown accustomed to at their disposal. But we do have more. We have so much more than we really need. We have so much more that we can't manage the more properly. We have more options at our disposal. More choices that we can contemplate over, and most of the time we don't take advantage of them. Banking options, online, in person, ATM, but we complain of long lines and fewer branches. We have our choices of restaurant and shopping centers, worship places, and schools. Our ancestors didn't have those options. When you went to church, you didn't have to ask which one. Everybody went to the same church house. When it was time for school, all kids attended the same one-room house, but they were still taught. When shopping, there were limited places to go because of black and white only. They weren't blessed with the kinds of choices we have today. They just made do. Those differences also speak to the faith we have in God to provide. When they were asked, well, are you okay? Do you need anything? They would always say, God takes care of us. We are doing just fine. And they meant it, and they believed it, because they knew God's way always worked, and he would come through. In a time when others are prospering and seem to be doing better, why don't we trust God when it looks like we are struggling to make ends meet? Why can't we believe that God is moving on our behalf? Why is it that we think more means better? Well, the world wants us to believe you need a whole lot to make things happen. We go to the store every day getting stuff. Even in this pandemic, we're still getting more. We're buying more shoes, more clothes, and more toilet paper. I still have not gotten that yet. Infatuation with toilet paper is. What could you possibly need right now that you don't already have? Why are you shopping? But you know, it's the nature of the beast. I know I do it all. I do it too. I'm an Amazonian. I need to own some stock in it. I'm not talking about essentials like food and gas and personal items. I'm talking about overage. I was talking to a friend of mine last week about how I was cleaning out my closet, and I looked at all the purses I bought over the years. I've had a purse and a shoe fetish, y'all. But I realized it was excessive. At the time I bought them, it was because I liked them because of the color or the size or the name brand. But now I barely carry one. I have a clutch, the same clutch I pick up and put down whenever I need to. But we are still spending money on things that don't even matter. So now I have over a dozen purses in my closet that are not being used. And I know we think if I have all this stuff, it'll secure my greater. I'll be in the made it club. But here it is, while we spend time getting the more, we still end up operating in the less. Since March 12th, I haven't been to the hair salon, as you can see, nail salon, or worn makeup every day in these last 6 months. But I found that those things are preferences, and most of them wants. I haven't missed out on anything not having those services. I'm still blessed and favored. My house note is paid. I still have food on my table. I still have my peace of mind, and I still have my family. I'm content with my life. Still got my health, amen. Nobody has to help me get dressed in the morning. I've been on my pandemic perch every day. I love being still in this quarantine, not having to go here, there, and everywhere. I don't need to be on the scene for every event. I don't need to have a packed schedule every week to say I'm progressing and producing. I don't need quantity. I'm looking for quality. I don't need $1 million. If my bill is $250, just give me that. I don't need 5,000 friends, just one or two will do. Everything doesn't require massive, but if you do it with excellence and have the right strategy, God will get the glory. And you need to know, he would do it on his own terms, and it won't take a whole lot. Don't believe me? Little becomes much when you place it in the master's hands. And I can tell you're not feeling me, so let me show you. He took two fish, five loaves, and fed 5,000 men and had overflow. He gave David five stones, but only one killed Goliath. He enabled Samson to kill 1,000 men using a jawbone of a donkey. Here's another example in the story of Gideon. I love this story, Gideon. A loyal and noble man who loved God, but Gideon was the judge. But he was also skeptical, thinking he was inadequate, didn't have what it takes. As the story goes, Lord, these poor Israelites, they have done evil in the sight of the Lord. So God handed them over to Midian. And their lives were miserable. They were being terrorized. They were being bullied by the Midianites. They killed their crops and they took their livestock. So Israel was impoverished. They had nothing. They even moved to live in caves to hide from the Midianites. It got so bad that Israel cried out to God, and he heard them, and he wanted to deliver them. But to do so, God must raise a leader and an army in Israel to fight the cruel Midianites. Well, he called on an humble farmer, Gideon. He was also a farmer. Y'all heard me say before, he was a judge, but he was also a farmer. He called on Gideon to raise up a mighty army. Now, Gideon's recruits at first was 32,000 weak. That's a lot of people, isn't it? That's an army. But then they were 300 strong. God had to structure it so Gideon would be victorious. I'm so glad God knows us, because he had a funny feeling and a sneaking suspicion that Gideon wasn't quite prepared, so he had to position him to win. Because Gideon was so doubtful, God had to show him who had the power. God already told Midian he was going to hand Midian over to him. He said, look, you're going to be victorious. You're going to win. God said, I promise you victory if you just go and fight. I'm going to say that again. He said, I promise you victory if you just go and fight. So Gideon gathered up all the Israelites, got up early, and set up camp not too far from Midian to prepare for attack. Thinking Gideon is ready, the Lord looked around and said, there are way too many people with Gideon to hand over the victory. With so many people, they will perhaps claim the victory of their own power and not God's doing. See, you got to remember, God will get the glory. So let's do an assessment of this quantitative gesture over qualitative preference. I try to be like my bishop, act like I have, so y'all have some education. what do I need to do to get in position, myself in position for the victory in my life? Well, the first thing is blatantly, God will blatantly weed out the ones who are unnecessary. God will blatantly weed out the ones. So blatantly means unsubtle. It'll be obvious. It won't be hard, and you won't have to guess. It'll be quick and easy. You all got your swords with you? He says in verse 2, there are too many to hand over to the Midianites. You brought Juju, Lil Shorty, and Mom and them. We don't need all that. Some of y'all have to go. Y'all know what I'm talking about. We show up to the football game 20 deep. We go shopping with all 8 of our friends. We go to the movies with an entire neighborhood, then we scatter when we get there. We host something every night because we are the happening house. Y'all got too many folks. Somebody has to go. So here's your test. How many were there in total? And I'm so, I didn't even know, of course, when God gave me this, you all were going to be here, but this is great because now I have a class. All right, class, how many were there in total from the beginning? That's in the last part of verse 3. There were 32,000 men, Lord, this poor class. Y'all pray for them on TV. There were 32,000 men. How many went home? 22,000. So that left 10,000 willing, but they were wimpy. How did he determine who needed to go home? Verse 3 says, fear and trembling. So all the scaredy cats have to go home. So you turn to your neighbor and ask your neighbor, are you trembling? If you're scared, you will mess up the plan. You won't hit the target, Margaret. It's like tryouts. When you're trying out for a team, they need to see your skills. So if you can't hit the ball, shoot the ball, like Kuzma last night with the Lakers, or throw the ball, you're a liability. If you're not performing at the speed and frequency level of need, you will not make the roster. You'll just be in the way. So it says all the scaredy cats go home, not sit down, not stand to the side, go back home. We don't even need your vibe in the atmosphere. Since you can't decide, the scared ones need to leave because they would disrupt what I'm trying to do. Their disbelief will cause grief. He's sending home all the people you don't want to get rid of that you think you can save. Let them be scared at the house. Let them be scared without you right now. You don't need them to win. They obviously can't go with you because God is sending them away. There are people in your life that are hanging around, not making a contribution in your life. All they're doing is inciting fear and doubt to every plan and strategy. They're not for you. They just want to be in the crowd. But send them home. You, after the fight, you can call them and say, somebody said that it couldn't be done, but I'm going to tell you, I did it. God said, send them home. He's already fixed the fight. He just needs you to trust him. You need to tell the people that come and sit in your house day in and day out just to go home. You're contributing to the toxicity in the air. You're blocking my best. Send them home. But the next thing is, blending in will get you blended out. Blending in will get you blended out. Verse 4 says, God said to Gideon, bruh, there's still too many people. And I know y'all are saying, well, isn't he supposed to have an army? How many more will he send away? I had that question too, because I said, well, he's supposed to have an army. Well, I did some research and found out army is a group of two or more people. Just two or more, and that's an army. Y'all an army sitting back there on that row, y'all an army. So it doesn't take a whole lot. So I know you're thinking, if you got rid of everybody who's scared, then who's left? And I'm about to show you. God said, let's go down to the river. A lot can happen at the river. There's clarity at the river. There's deliverance at the river. There's revelation at the river. We're going to a reveal party. Y'all know what a reveal party is. It's when they get to reveal the gender. So we're going to a reveal party. We're going to see if you're a lapper or if you're a kneeler. Okay, so we get to the river, And the stipulation in verse 5 says, those who lap like dogs could stay, and those who kneel go home. And you know why? Because he who laps long laps judgment. Y'all like my pun? I'm the grammar police, because y'all know 2 and 2 and there on Facebook be killing me. And I need y'all to get this laps, L-A-P-S, and laps, L-A-P-S-E. When you lap like a dog, you can endure the fatigue and thirst that comes when fighting. Laps is a slight error in judgment or in attentiveness. When you're kneeling, you're belaboring the refreshment. When you're in battle, there's no time for breaks and rest. You can't stop. You can't sit down. You're on the battlefield, and you got shots being fired at you every second, and you have bullets flying everywhere. You don't have time for a Snickers. You're in battle. You're in combat. You're trying to overtake. You're trying to win. And when you're on the front line, you've got to be all in and stay in. You've got to be girded up, committed, and convicted, steadied and shouldered up. I've got to know I can count on you to the end, that you won't go hiding and leave me out there by myself. I need to know, are you a lapper or are you a kneeler? You better check your friends, your neighbors, and your loved ones. In this pandemic, it's been revealed to some of you all who you can count on. It's been uncovered who's been secretly resisting your progress. Wolves in sheep clothing, acting like they're for you. God said, I will snatch you up out of there before you destroy what I set up. Blending in will get you blended out. So he'll blatantly weed out the ones who aren't necessary. He'll take out the ones who are trying to blend in. But then blessings come when you least expect it. Bishop, this blessed me when the Lord gave me this word and I started reading and doing research. But guess what? Gideon was scared too. He was very uncertain. So much so that God told him, all right, if you're too scared, take somebody with you. So if he knew he was scared, why did God choose Gideon? I'm sure like Gideon, you had reservations about your own inhibitions. Lord, I am afraid to sing in front of people. Why would you task me with being the praise and worship leader? Lord, I don't know anything about caring for children. Why would you bless me with being a mother? Father, why would you assign me to teach? What if I lead them wrong or don't prepare them properly? Sweet baby Jesus, I know nothing about cooking and I can barely clean for one. Why would you bless me with a godly spouse? Why me, Lord? Well, over in chapter 6, around verse 15, he chose Gideon because his family was the least significant in the house of Manasseh, of all the tribes, and he was the smallest in his family. So because of his skepticism, Gideon gathered up everybody he could to go to battle. When you're scared, you need a crowd to make you feel confident to deflect your own lack of ability. But I'm here to tell you, when it seems as though you don't have a whole lot, God will position you. Less is best. You might feel unworthy, but you're not all over the place. And God knows he can trust you. He fights for the underdog. You might not have a 5-room house, but your 1-room apartment is neat as a fiddle. You might not drive a Tesla, but your Chevy will get you from point A to point B, and it's paid for. You don't have a Louis bag on your arm, but your bag carries everything you need. God needed to get the glory, so he whittled down Gideon's army to orchestrate the biggest takeover in history. 300 men against 125,000 men. Who does that? Then here comes the caveat. You all go over to verse 10. Look down at verse 10. To sweeten the deal, he said, go down to the camp with your servant Purah. Purah was his armor bearer. He said, take him with you to sneak in the Midianite camp to hear what was being said. Take one person with you. You know what I noticed? God had a lot of patience with Gideon. He showed patience with him, but also gave him security and assurance. He was patient with him because he was encouraging him. When you're being encouraged, there's a level of safety. He was assuring him that to make sure he would see it through. When you see potential, God will give you patience. It's like a teacher that takes extra time with a child that needs assurance, or a mentor who's grooming his or her apprentice, or a parent that holds onto the seat of a bicycle when the child is learning to ride. So he said, if you must, take Pura with you. God will take all the time he needs because you're worth it. He will give you even a road dog to make sure your assignment is fulfilled. Not your family, not Lily and them. He will give you one person. Tell me, who is the Pura in your life that will be your eyes and your ears? Who is a road dog that will go with you no matter the cost? Who can you call on when you just need the safety of someone's presence? If you don't have anyone, you better find your Pura. I'm sure it's the person you probably would never think fits the bill, or it may be your boo or your bestie. When you need someone to go with you to the battle, they show up before you make the call, and they're willing and able. It's called partnership. Somebody say partnership. Barack had Deborah, Batman had Robin, and the Lone Ranger had Tonto. Even in your willingness, you may have doubts, but when I tell you, God would assure you by blessing you when you least expect it. Gideon had doubts because of his ability. Gideon felt defeated because God depleted the size of his army. Gideon overheard the dream, but he still needed assurance. As a matter of fact, God assured Gideon three times. It's like, what else do you need? How else can I show you? His patience with us is in the unexpected blessings. There's a story of a boy and his friend named Kyle. Their freshman year, he noticed a boy from his class on his walk home. He realized he hadn't seen him walk that way before and wondered why was he carrying all of his books home on a Friday. Nobody carries their books home for the weekend because y'all know we don't really want to. Well, that's how it was when I was in school, but anyway. But he just shrugged it off. Well, the other kids that were walking home started bullying him. They were knocking the books out of his hands and tripping him up. His glasses went flying off his face, and so he was down on the ground looking for them. The boy went over to him and said, "Don't worry about them. They're jerks. What's your name?" The boy said, "My name is Kyle." So he helped him find his glasses, and he carried half of his books home. He asked, "Why haven't I seen you around here before, Kyle?" Kyle said, "I was at a private school, and we moved, so I'm at this school now." As they walked on, he found out Kyle lived around the corner from him. He asked, "Do you want to hang out this weekend? There's a football game and a few parties I'm going to." Of course, Kyle said yes. Well, from then on, they were inseparable. He realized Kyle was kind of cute, cool, and his friends liked him too. Through the years, Kyle became the social butterfly, even dating a little. They were the best of friends. When it was time to graduate, they were sharing what they were going to do with their lives, and both mentioned college opportunities. Kyle wanted to be a doctor, and his friend was going to study business on a football scholarship. As it turns out, when the graduation day came, Kyle was the valedictorian, so of course the valedictorian has to make a speech. He looked nervous, but his friend said to him, "You'll do great." When Kyle approached the podium, he started his speech. "This is the time you thank people who helped you along the way. It could be your parents, siblings, or even a coach. But I want to tell you about my friend." His friend, of course, in the audience immediately knew he was going to share the day they met. Kyle went on with his story. "When I met my friend on my way home from school, I was the new kid on the block my freshman year. He had no idea that weekend I had planned on committing suicide. I had cleaned out my locker so my mom wouldn't have to do it. Thankfully, I was saved. He kept me from doing the unthinkable." Kyle's parents turned and smiled at him. "You never know what one small move can do. He saved my life, and I want to publicly tell him thank you." You may have a similar story. You never know where God is sending you or to help or to guide someone through a difficult time or out of a dark place. But when you're obedient, it puts you in the right space at the right time. Gideon unexpectedly defeated the Midianites because God intervened and saved his life. Kyle got the deal of a lifetime. He was tired of being bullied. He had had enough and was ready to call it quits. All it takes is one person to make a difference. Many will come by, but all it takes is one. We find out in this quarantine that less is best. In this pandemic, there ain't no party, or there shouldn't be anyway. We've learned whenever there's been a large gathering that there's been a COVID diagnosis as a result. Schools have to shut down and restaurants close back up. This isn't party time, this is prime time. We're in a fixed time period. There are no more drive-by parades and Zoom. There are drive-by parades and Zoom celebrations. There are no more destination weddings and birthday cruises. You got weddings happening in neighborhoods, in the streets, so the village can celebrate you, not the locals of whatever distant land islands you choose. God has helped us use the resources we have to be grateful for the simpler things in life. It can be done if we allow God to set it up. You save time and money, but you can't put a price on gratitude. You can't buy contentment. Little does become much when you place it in the master's hand. We've been shown it's possible, but we always look to the bigness of things to satisfy instead of the beauty of God's sovereignty. God will get the glory if you look to the simpler things he's showing to bless you. Bishop's birthday was Thursday, and the weeks leading up to it, his head was hanging low because we're so used to celebrating in big fashion. All of the hoopla of dinner or a party of something outside the home. But I turned to him and said, God has healed you, and you have your life, your strength, your family, and a blessed church that loves you and is thriving in this season. Let's celebrate that you're alive. We'll live it up big at the house, and live it up we did. When you don't define success by the big things, God will turn the little things into greater. In Matthew, the story of the mustard seed that a man sowed in the field is smaller than all the seeds, but when it's grown, it's become a tree that the birds can make their nest. Jesus was a baby in a manger in a stink stable among the animals in Bethlehem, but he was chosen to save the world. God can use something or someone small to do something great because of your obedience. When you're faithful to God, he'll be faithful to you. He gives a promise with his patience. Stop looking for the big idea. All you need is something simple and useful. Stop looking for 1,000 likes on your page. All you need is one to say that it made them meaningful. Stop looking for accoutrements. Look to the Ancient of Days. He has all power in his hands. You want the bigness? The greater God is greater. He's awesome in power. That's our God. So when we say less is best, that less is probably in your house, but it's underneath all that bigness that you decided to get to make sure that you made it in the club and that people can see that, oh, you got it made, that you have everything in your house. But no, that's not it. Those are some of the things that God didn't tell me to give, but I just needed to make sure that I was straight, that those things were going to make me who I am. Less is best. And I bet you if you went back home right now, peel back the layers of all those things that you have, you'll find the answer to so many questions that you had as to why you didn't have this or as to why you didn't get that. Less is best. Clean out the clutter of your house and let God show you the answer that's been hidden under all your stuff. Less is best. You don't need 12 pairs of shoes. You need just one just to make it through. Less is best. You don't need 12,000 purses. All you need is one to make it through every day. Less is best because God will get the glory out of this. I said God will get the glory out of this. You may be by yourself, but less is best. I can do bad all by myself. I don't need anybody else coming in here. They're not going to enhance me or make me who I need to be. Less is best. I don't need a whole lot of friends if they're going to flake out on me when I need them the most. Less is best. So you can take a hold of what God has for you. Amen. Amen. And amen. I pray this word has blessed you today. I pray that you saw yourself in this word on today, that you don't need a whole lot. And God can work a miracle in your life with the little bit that you have. If someone is watching this stream on today, I pray you've made a decision already to make Jesus your choice. If you already don't know him, if you've been skeptical and you didn't know what was going on in this disciple life, I pray that you've been encouraged on today to seek the Lord hit that button on our Bethel Experience Facebook page right now. It says Decisions on Demand. You can click on that and join as a new disciple or join our church. This branch of Zion, who's still doing ministry even in this pandemic, we would love to have you as part of the Bethel Experience. It's called BBE, the Bethel, BEE, the Bethel Experience Everywhere. And so now, as we are a global church because we are online, we still want you to be part of this ministry. We have amazing leadership here. If you have not heard our bishop and this is your first time tuning in, I promise you, he is an amazing man of God, and he will bless your life because God will give him what you need for your life. We thank you for being with us on today. I pray that you sowed on this word today. We pray that you sowed in this ministry on today. Cash App, the Bethel Experience, Givelify, Bethel Baptist Church, and then text to give Bethel Jax to 77977. Sow to this ministry, sow on this word, sow into your life today by giving, because that's your reasonable service. Amen. Amen. Bishop, I know he's coming. He's right here.
I don't want us to go anywhere. First of all, I want to pray, because there are some people watching, and as I watched comments, that God has given assignments to. There's a difference. I heard Bishop Hilliard say this the other night. There's a difference in doubt and unbelief. Doubt is when I'm not sure how God's going to do it. Unbelief is when I say God can't do it. And I believe there are people that are watching. Some might even be in here who heard this word today. Some of you are in doubt. I know it was God that told me to do. I know it was God that told me to take the job, to move to the new city. I know it was God that told me to give. I know that it was God that told me to take this assignment, but I'm in doubt. I'm scared because I don't know how he's going to do it. There are others of you who sound insecure, but it's really arrogant, because you're saying, I don't think God can use me. The arrogance of that statement, to think that what's wrong with you is more powerful than what's right with God. And after a word like this today that tried to challenge you that you don't need all those people and all those things, that God will give you an that's what got me. An army is two or three people. Perhaps that's why the word of God says where two or three touch and agree. That's the only army I need. You got too many folk in your corner. All you need are two or three. And I want to pray. I want to pray because this word, it was challenging to see where I need to downsize my life. It was challenging to all of us to see where we need to downsize what the Lord has called us to do. And so I want to pray for you. You're watching right now. I hope you haven't jumped off the screen like you run out the sanctuary as soon as the sermon is over. But I want to pray right now. I want to pray. I want you to bow your heads with me in your home, or if you're driving, pull over. Find a parking lot and pull over real quick. If you're on the job, sneak away to the break room, because I want to pray. So God, right now I pray that this word this morning will help us know that our power is not always in the upgrade, it's in the downsides. Help us to realize this morning that you never give us an assignment that you haven't already equipped us for. So God, today I pray for somebody's discernment to know that everything they need to be equipped with, from gift to connections, has already been provided for them. I pray right now, God, that we will cancel the assignment of insecurity that has us believing that what's wrong with us is greater than what's right with you. The devil is a liar. I speak to the insecure. I speak to the inferior today. And I declare and I say to you that it is what's wrong with you that made God call you. Because when God uses you, you will only be able to give God the credit. God, today, give us the confidence we need to cut out the kneelers. Give us the confidence we need today to cut out those who are scared, who speak negativity over our lives. Show us our pura. Show us those that are to be connected to us in this season. And I declare and decree that everything you said you're going to do, it shall come to pass. Everything you declared you will do through us, it shall happen. Thank you for this woman of God. Thank you for using her today to challenge us on the blessing of downsizing. Pour it back into her, God. Continue to use her in powerful ways. Thank you for everyone that was blessed virtually today. That's going to start looking around to see who doesn't need to be on their side in this season. In Jesus' name. Listen, before you move, you ought to go sow. I hear it in the Holy Ghost, a $77 seed. I hear that in the Holy Ghost. Bishop, why am I sowing that seed? Because there are some seasons that are over. Seven is the number of completion. I hear it in the Holy Ghost. There are some seasons that are complete for people that have been in your life. There are some seasons of thinking that is complete and done and over. I want you to go right now. Sow that $77 seed. And here's my prophetic utterance to you. As you sow that seed, God is getting ready to reveal to you the people that need to go with you to the next season. I want you to hear me in the Holy Ghost. Sow that seed today. The revelation God's going to give you is not because you sowed the 77. Watch me. The revelation is going to, the manifestation and the revelation of who is to be with you is going to happen because you were obedient to what your man of God asked you to do. Go sow that seed right now and watch how God is going to bless you. I hope you were blessed today. Where you going? Yeah, come back over here. The woman of God blessed us today. She blessed us today. We thank God for her. Hey, I want to challenge every one of you to be on midweek manna on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. You're missing a blessing. I want to challenge you, if you have not registered for digital discipleship, the flyers will be up on our social media all week long. You need to register as we begin our small groups. This has been a blessed Sunday, an incredible word. She taught me some stuff. And I'm supposed to be the professor. She blessed us today. And I've already texted the Covenant Brothers because they punked me this morning and didn't tell me nothing was coming. All they kept saying was, we going to watch Kim this morning. And they punked me good. I love my church. I promise you it's the greatest church on the planet. Hey, we love you all. We thank God for you. You have a great rest of the day. And be blessed. Peace.
It's just a day of surprises. Everybody say happy birthday to our bishop. Going to ask everybody if you guys can go ahead and go outside before the bishop gets out. So you guys go straight out, go to your cars, go wherever you gotta go.
Can y'all hear me? Huh? What tan is? All right. Huh? My mic is on. All right, I'll be careful. What y'all got? What in the world is going on out here? So now I understand why you were up when I texted you. And I told my wife, I said, I am shocked. Tiffany don't be up this early. All right. What in the world y'all got going on out here? Huh? You know, I almost ordered this. Well, what in the world? Lord have mercy. Boy, y'all done punked me today. Y'all done punked me today. I cannot win. Okay, so this chair goes to my office. Y'all done pumped me today. So this is what my father was talking about yesterday. Hey, happy, thank you, Lord. Y'all have punked me. Y'all done punked me today. Lord, have mercy. Bless you, baby. Thank you. It's so good to see you. Huh? Okay. Oh, we're on Facebook, too? Lord, thank you. Lord, have mercy. So for all y'all listening on Facebook, I done been punked today. They done put me in a seat and doing a drive-by. Bless y'all. For my birthday, Lord, Lord have mercy. So they tell me it's still live on Facebook, y'all. And they honking the horns. Hey, baby, bless you. Y'all, the church done punked me today for real. They done punked me and got a drive-by. Hey! They done punked me, y'all. Then got me in this big seat. Bless you. Thank you. Lord have mercy. Just give me the car. I just want the car. Y'all done punked me today. Y'all done punked me today. Thank you, baby. Thank you all. Lord have mercy. Lord, y'all, they got balloons. They got signs. Thank you, baby. I wish y'all could see how they have punked me today. Hey! Lord have mercy. People giving gifts. Okay, so the folk on Facebook, how do y'all want them to give gifts? Do you want them to sew? Y'all, they got my Omega. I wish y'all could see this. I'm shocked y'all didn't get my mom and dad up here. Hey! Y'all all right? Thank you. Thank you. Y'all done got me. I wish y'all could see this. Lord, y'all got me today. Y'all got me today. Lord have mercy. Hey! Bless y'all. Okay, so why this check ain't go in my office? Why this check ain't go in my office? sick, y'all. Bless Lord, they got it all on us. Y'all done got me good. Hey, thank you. Hey, one of y'all FaceTime Janae. Lord. Thank you. Love y'all. Thank you. Lord, have mercy. Bless y'all. Thank you. Yeah, don't get confused. Y'all got me good today. Huh? I know I am. Yeah, I know I am. They warned me. Hey, twin, hope you had a good birthday. I'm good. She did. Hey! You get Janae? Oh, okay. Thank you, baby. Hey! I know. Boy. Bless you, baby. Bless you. Boy, y'all gonna get it. Hey, baby. Bless you. Y'all got me good. Y'all got me good. Got me good. Hey, bless you. Wow. Wow, 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 wow. 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 Bless you, baby. Y'all got me good today, boy. Hey, y'all back again. Lord have mercy. Uh-huh. Well, y'all got me. Y'all got me. Y'all got me. I gotta admit, y'all got me. Y'all got me good. Y'all got me good. Y'all got me good. Y'all got me good. Y'all got me good.
Huh? Except the Chanel bag, right? Huh? Yes. Yeah. This, y'all got me good. But whoever was in charge of that music, I need a conference with them. Who was in charge of that music? Am I? Well, Facebook, y'all need to pray for the entire music ministry that they don't get terminated this week. Yeah, please. Yes. Huh? Yeah. All right, where am I going?